This is my family album. All the pictures that I remember seeing as a little girl and as an adult. All the stories that I remember. I looked at my grandfather's picture and my grandmother's picture. All of those pictures just bring back such fond memories. Why, I remember when I was just 3 years old, I lived with my grandparents. Spent the first 6 years of my life with my grandparents. We lived way out in a place called Second Creek. That's between First and Third. That's what my granddaddy used to say all the time. It was an old country house. And I loved that old country house. Had a porch that went all the way around. I'm not so sure that my grandparents knew what to do with me. They had raised 14 children, and here was a new life. My mother was the baby of the family. And my grandmother agreed to take care of me. I think she was proud of me, but my grandfather was, so I didn't worry about anybody else. We would go to church on Sundays. I remember. And we had a mile to walk from my grandmother's house. We walked past Aunt Sally's house up on the hill and get on the road. And Grandpa walked slow because he had arthritis. So I'd run ahead and get to the church and stand there on the church steps. And somebody would always open the door and they'd say, "Well, would you like to come in?" And I'd say, "Uh-huh." And they'd say, "Well, come on in." And I'd say, "I got to wait on my granddaddy." And they'd look down the road and see Miss Ola and Mr. Jim on their way, and they knew exactly who I was. My granddaddy would get there, say, "Come on in the church, gal." And the person opening the door would say, "Why, Miss Ola, is this your granddaughter?" My grandmother would say, "Yes. I raised 14 children. All my children were seen and not heard. But this one is seen and heard at the same time." Well, I was proud of that. I'd just push out my chest. My granddaddy would say, "Lord, have mercy." We'd walk into the church. My granddaddy always sat on that first bench, right in front of the pulpit. My grandmother behind him, and I'd sit beside her, and beside me was my Aunt Sally. That was my grandfather's sister. My grandfather had 7 brothers and 1 sister. I liked Aunt Sally. Aunt Sally was fat. She wore a low-cut dress all the time. And when she walked, she jiggled. Ah, I wanted to jiggle just like Aunt Sally. My grandmother used to say, "Be careful what you ask God for. He may give it to you." Well, I was blessed with Aunt Sally's jiggle. She used to wear a brooch right up under that jiggle. Folks would come over to our seat. And they would say, "Oh, Miss Sally, that's a fine brooch you've got on." And my Aunt Sally, who kept a fan inside her sleeve, would remove that fan and open it. And she would fan herself and she would say, "Thank you, Mr. Jones, for noticing my new brooch." And my grandmother would say, "Lord, have mercy." And we'd get home. And my grandmother would talk terrible about Aunt Sally. Well, I didn't know it was terrible. I thought it was wonderful. Well, she was back in the kitchen and she was cooking and throwing dishes from one place to the other. And my grandmother would say, "Jim, that sister of yours needs somebody to talk to her. She's in bad shape. Sally's an out-and-out hussy. I like that word, hussy. I was 3 years old, sounded good to me. I used to sit on the porch and say it. Hussy. 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 One day we were at the church. It was big meeting time. And everybody was just sort of waiting on my grandmother to get her cake and her pie and all of her table set up first. But she couldn't do it because I was underfoot. So they thought, get Jackie away from Miss Ola and we can get this table set. So they called me, come here, Jackie, sit down right here. So I'd go over and I'd sit down and I'd say, yes. They'd say, you're a pretty girl. And I'd say, I know. They'd say, well, those are pretty shoes you've got on. And I'd say, my granddaddy bought them for me. And they'd say, that's a pretty dress. And I'd say, yes, I know that too. Well, then I'd get up to leave. And they'd say, wait a minute. What would a nice little girl like you want to be when she grows up? And I'd stand up and I'd look them straight in the eye and I'd say, I want to be a hussy like my Aunt Sally. Well, my grandmother would hear that. Now, don't you let anybody tell you that homemade soap is sweet. I don't know why I've got taste buds. She washed my mouth out with soap. Now, she said the word, not me. But it sounded good. We'd sit there in church. And my grandfather had a special job in the church. I've checked around for years and tried to see if anybody else had a job like that. After we had prayed a couple of times, sung a couple of hymns, took up some money, the preacher would stand up in the pulpit, and that was my grandfather's signal to get up and go up in the pulpit. And you know, he would sit in the preacher's chair. Then I'd see my granddaddy remove his watch from his pocket and place it over his arm. And while the preacher was preaching, I'd see my granddaddy looking at his watch every now and then. And when 35 minutes was up, my granddaddy would lean over and grab the preacher's coattail and pull it. That meant shut up. My granddaddy was the coattail puller, the official coattail puller. At least that's what Aunt Sally called him. Aunt Sally was a wonderful lady. I used to hug her, and she smelled so sweet. I asked my grandmother one day, why does Aunt Sally smell so good? My grandmother said, she uses vanilla flavoring for perfume. Oh, I thought, it's so sweet. So one day when my grandmother was baking, there were some little jars on the table, and I said, what's that? She said, that's lemon flavoring. And I said, what's that? And she said, that's vanilla flavoring. So when my grandmother had a back turn, I grabbed the vanilla flavoring, went out on the porch and opened it up, shook it all over me from my head to my toes. The flies and the gnats and the bees chased me around the house at least 15 times. My grandmother said, let that be a lesson to you. They changed the formula. There are pictures in this family album of Aunt Sally's husband. This was her fifth husband. Now, I believe her other husbands had passed away. I don't know what happened to them. But you know, I didn't know that the man had a name. Because I'd always hear people say, here comes Sally and her fifth husband. And then I'd hear people say, that's Miss Sally Carson. That's her fifth husband. So I didn't know he had a name other than fifth. So I called him Uncle Fifth. One day when I thought that was wrong, when I found out it was wrong, I was standing on the porch in front of my grandmother, and Aunt Sally was coming down the hill to visit. Uncle Fifth was behind her. So I decided to be the first one to greet Aunt Sally. I threw my hand up, "Hey, Aunt Sally." "Hey, Uncle Fifth." And you know I fell off that porch, because I felt somebody's foot in my back. Well, I got up and I looked around, and then I looked at my grandmother's foot, because I was standing right in front of my grandmother. My granddaddy said, "Did you fall, gal? Get on up." He knew what happened to me. I thought that was the man's name. Uncle Fifth was a nice man. He used to say to my granddaddy, "Jim, why you reckon this young'un's called me Uncle Fifth?" And my granddaddy would say, "Well, you know, I don't know." He knew. My granddaddy was a good old man. I had a speech impediment. I had impacted teeth, so I couldn't talk real good. And my granddaddy would always caution folks when they'd say anything to me, "Don't answer yes to anything she says, because you don't know what she's saying." So everybody would just kind of say, "Huh?" when I'd ask them something. But my grandfather loved me anyway. I talked all the time. Even with that speech impediment, I talked day and night. We'd go for a walk. I'd say, "Granddaddy, what's that?" He'd say, "That's a tree." "Granddaddy, what's that?" He'd say, "That's a rock." "What's that, Granddaddy?" He'd say, "That's another tree." And when he'd get tired of me just talking and talking and talking, he'd say, "Wait a minute, listen." I'd say, "Granddaddy, what are we listening for?" He'd say, "Well, I ain't gonna be able to hear it if you keep running your mouth." They'd put me in the bed at 6 o'clock. I guess they had had enough of my conversation. Well, you know, when you go to bed at 6 o'clock in the day, you're ready to get up at 4. And I would. I'd go down to Grandma's room, stand right outside the door. I was a respectful child. And I'd call, "Grandma." I wouldn't go in. "Grandma." I knew she was awake, because she moved her eyes. She just never would open them. So I'd call her, "Grandma." Now, my grandpa would open one eye and look at me. So I'd call her again, "Grandma." My grandpa would say, "Ola, does she have to make all that fuss?" My grandmother, with both eyes closed, would say, "Yes, it's her job." My grandmother would wake up and she'd say, "Listen, why are you waking us up?" I'd say, "Well, Grandma, I've been asleep all night. I'm ready to get up." She'd say, "It's 4 o'clock in the morning. It's dark out there." I'd say, "Okay, I want to go out." She'd say, "All right, go out on the porch. Go anywhere you want to go. Don't leave the porch." "Okay." She said, "And don't be hanging around out there with that gown on either." So I get up in the mornings at 4 o'clock, hang my gown across the bed, go downstairs, lift the latch, go out on the porch. My favorite toy was kept near the kitchen door. That's so my grandma could see me when she was up. That was my tricycle. I'd get on that tricycle, and Grandma's porch went all the way around the house. So I'd ride. That was the quietest vehicle I owned. So I would ride around the porch, and it was so quiet. You could just hear a little bumbity, 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 bumbity. I'd turn around, bumbity, 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 bumbity. Boomity, 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 boom. It sounded so good. So I made up a song to go along with it. Had one note. The tricycle sounded like boomity, 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 boomity. And my song sounded like ah. Well, after about 15, 20 times around the porch, my granddaddy was standing in the door hollering at me, hey, hey, hey. And I'd say, hey, hey. I thought he was speaking to me. He'd say, oh, my Lord. He'd step back in the house and call my grandmother. Ola, come out here and look at this gal. She's riding this tricycle around the porch, naked as a jaybird. Well, I'd have to get off the tricycle and go in the house and get on clothes. But they told me to take the gown off. They didn't say anything about putting on clothes. And see, when you're 3 years old, it's easier to take them off than to put them on. Well, my granddaddy would call me in, and to keep me quiet, he'd say, all right, I'm going to tell you a story. He'd sit there with his walking cane, and he'd hold on to that walking cane. He'd look at me, and he'd look at the walking cane, and then he'd say, gal, what story would you like to hear? And you know, I used to think way back in my mind, you invited me in here. You ought to know one. I never said that. I loved the stories that he would tell about Brer Rabbit. Oh, my. But I didn't believe him. I said, Granddaddy, ain't nobody living like Brer Rabbit. And he'd say, yes, it is. We'd go up to Aunt Sally's house, and sure enough, little old brown rabbit would run across the road. Granddaddy would say, who is that? I said, that's a rabbit. He'd say, but who is it? I said, it's a rabbit, a brown rabbit. He'd say, that's Brer Rabbit. I said, no, it's not. You said that the gray rabbit that went across the road yesterday was Brer Rabbit. This one's brown. My granddaddy would look me straight in the eye, and he would say, you change your clothes, don't you? Well, that's what made me know that Brer Rabbit was real. He changed clothes. I love my granddaddy's stories. He was a patient old man, too. When he was able to get around, he built my grandmother a quilt frame. She loved to quilt. She had scraps, granddaddy called them rags. She had scraps from every place in the world. If we had a dress or a coat, she'd tear it up and cut up little scraps. And it would end up in a quilt. But he made her frame, and he put it in the ceiling. And when Grandma wanted to sew on that quilt, she just unrolled those ropes, and that quilt frame would fall about 4 feet above the floor. And sometimes, oh, a lot of the women that lived out there in Second Creek would come and help my grandmother sew on her quilt top. I liked that. Because nobody was paying me any attention. And I could crawl under the quilt. And if I sat very still like this, I could hear what they were saying. I knew everybody's business. Of course, I didn't know what it was all the time, but I knew their business. One day, one of the women that used to come up to see Grandma and help her sew, her name was Mag. Aunt Sally said, I'm glad she ain't here. Grandma said, now don't say nothing ugly about Mag. Aunt Sally said, I ain't saying nothing ugly about her, Ola. The woman just worries me so bad. She talks all the time. Her mouth is so big you could back a big old truck up between her teeth. Well, I'm sitting under the quilt, and I'm thinking to myself, I sure do want to see that. Well, the next day at church, we were seated, Grandpa in the front, Grandma in the back, I was beside her, Aunt Sally on the other side. Now, my grandmother was a very proper church lady. She never once turned around to look behind her. Well, she said that was not nice. If the church blew up, she wouldn't turn around. But that wasn't me. I'd have to look or it would kill me. And she was always saying, hey, 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 turn around. Turn around. Hey, turn around. And I was always turning to the other side. This particular Sunday, I heard the church door open, and I happened to look. Who was coming down the middle of the church but Miss Meg? And I thought, this is a chance to see it. Where did she sit? Right behind us. This was even better. I got up on my knees, put my elbows up on the seat, and looked at her. She tried to make me turn around. But I looked. Finally, she waved at me. I was so busy looking that I didn't see her. So I just looked. Finally, my grandmother realized that I was turned completely around in the seat. So she tapped me on the shoulder. Turn around. I didn't. She shook my dress tail. I didn't move. She pinched me on the leg, and I said, ouch! She said, shh. What are you doing? She said. I said, I'm waiting. Shh. You waiting for what? I said, see the truck back up between her teeth? I knew I was in trouble. I knew the minute it got out of my mouth that I was in trouble. My grandmother grabbed me, pulled me off that seat. My feet hit the floor twice on the way out of the church. She pulled me outside and said, sit down. I said, all right. She went across the road, tore off three peach switches, plaited them. Took me back in the church. I can't tell you what the preacher preached about that day because I was too busy trying to stop crying. From that day on, she never once pulled that frame down without looking to see where I was located. Oh, it was a wonderful time that I spent out there. 6 whole years I had. Wonderful food. But you know, I was alone with adults. All the children had grown up and gone away. I was all by myself out there with two old folks who didn't know what in the world to do with this little girl. But they loved me. One day, I was playing on the back steps. It was late in the fall, but it was still warm. And I was playing with some toys that my mother had sent me from Chicago. And one of my toys was a wind-up Ferris wheel. It was yellow and black, and it had a clown's face that went around and around, and the little seats in it would turn all around, and I'd wind it up and I'd sit there and watch it. It had a little music box, and I'd stay there and play with it for hours. Well, that's what I was doing when I heard that laughter coming down through Mr. Lock Huffman's pasture. Well, that was the place of no return, because in that pasture was a bull that was big as the Wallace Building on the square in Salisbury, North Carolina. That was big. Well, it was a big old black bull. Had a great big brass ring through its nose. And my granddaddy said, if you go within 7 feet of that thing, he'll suck you in. We won't never see you anymore. I didn't go near it. And you know, the outhouse wasn't too far from the pasture. I never did make it to the outhouse. It's too close to the pasture. Didn't want anything to happen. Well, I heard this laughter. And I stood up on the porch, and down through the pasture came two little boys. Well, one was probably about 2 years older than me, and one was probably my age. They were dirty from their head to their toes, but they were little boys. And I had never seen children playing in the pasture, just that old bull. And I thought, oh, I'm gonna see that bull eat up those children. But they were running so fast that bull couldn't have caught them in 100 years. They fell down under that barbed wire fence and climbed out, and they were running and they were laughing as hard as they were running, and they ran right up to the porch and they looked up at me, and I looked down at them and we looked at each other. I said, hey. And they said, who are you? Well, I thought everybody knew me. So I told them, I'm Miss Jackie. And they said, well, Miss Jackie, do you live here? I said, yes. And then the little boy happened to notice the Ferris wheel. It was going kind of slow because it was slowing down. And he couldn't talk real good. He said, look. And his brother said, yeah. And he said, Miss Jackie, is that yours? And I said, yes, it is. My mama sent it to me. They said, can we see it? Well, I didn't know these children. But they were children. They were somebody to play with. And they said, we'll pay you. I was gonna get money. I said, okay. But they didn't have any money. They went in their pockets and they had two bottle caps, Coca-Cola bottle caps. And they had broken marbles and rocks and sticks and something that looked kind of like what a dog does after it's dried up. Well, they gave it to me in payment. Well, I didn't have any of this stuff. I didn't have a bottle cap or broken marble or rock or a dog turd. So I thought I'd take it. And I handed them the Ferris wheel. And they wound that thing. I've never seen it go so fast. Round and round and round and round. And they squealed and they laughed while I sorted through my treasures. Never had anything like this. And I love them. After a while, my grandmother heard something different on the porch. And she came out and she said, good heavens, where did you two come from? And they looked up at my grandmother, and you could see that every other little tooth was rotten. And my grandmother said, do you all live up there somewhere? And they said, uh-huh. My grandmother said, well, honey, I hear your mother calling you. And I listened. I didn't hear anything. My grandmother said, you must go home. So my grandmother went back in the house and she brought out 2 little sugar biscuits. That's what I ate for cookies. Grandma had good biscuits. She'd make those great big fat biscuits and put butter on them, and then she'd shake sugar and cinnamon on them. That's what's wrong with me now. Ate too many cinnamon biscuits. But she handed each one a cinnamon biscuit. And the little baby boy tried to pay my grandmother with, 2 bottle caps and a dog turd. But my grandmother said, no, thank you. You keep that. You may need it. She said, now go home. Your mama's calling you. Every day from that day on, my little friends came to play with me. And then one day I never saw them again. They just stopped coming. I never knew where they came from or where they went. But sometimes when I think about them, I sort of wished I knew where they were. We had the best time. And it's not everybody that can own a bottle cap and a dried up dog turd. And when I look at those pictures, those family pictures, I can't help but remember all those good times. My grandfather had arthritis, and he was a sick man. Because sometimes at night, I could hear my grandmother, my Aunt Mildred, and if my mother was at home, I could hear them running around in the house, and my grandfather was coughing, and oh, he was so sick. And I would climb down the stairs, and I would look around the door, and I could see them trying to clean him up. He was sick all the time. And he died. But I didn't understand what death was. So they just told me he went to heaven. I didn't like heaven so much. Because it took my granddaddy. And one day, I was seated on the porch with my Aunt Sally. It was Saturday. It had to be Saturday because that's when Aunt Sally would comb all that beautiful long hair out. And then she'd wet her hair and grease it. And then she'd wrap it with strings. And then Sunday morning when she'd take it loose, it would all be curly and wavy. And she'd still pack it back in that bun. But while she wrapped her hair with those strings, she would sing, oh, God's children got shoes. When I get to heaven, gonna put on my shoes. Gonna shout all over God's heaven. And I looked up at Aunt Sally and I said, don't you sing about heaven. She looked down at me and she said, Lord, child, why you so mad about heaven? I said, Aunt Sally, heaven took Paul, and it didn't give him back. She reached for me, and I was getting to be a big girl then. But I walked over to her and she pulled me up on her lap and she said, "You know, your granddaddy was mighty sick. He couldn't eat, he couldn't walk, he couldn't sleep at night, and he was all thin." She said, "He went to heaven, and heaven is the place that cures everything." She said, "Your granddaddy right at this minute is sopping cornbread in buttermilk. And about 2 hours later, he's gonna have him some cat head biscuits with sweet butter and molasses, fat back meat. He can eat anything he wants and it won't hurt him. And I bet you anything, he's walking all over heaven because he left his walking cane. He has no need for it. And he's fat and he's not feeling one pain." And I kind of thought about that. And I thought, well, heaven might not be so bad after all. Well, my Aunt Mildred decided that the country was too much. My grandmother was by herself. She had to bring in water from the well. She had to make candles. We didn't have electricity. She had to go way down in the old gully and get the hen's eggs because they would wander off. And my Aunt Mildred said, "This is too much." So she brought me and Grandma to town, Salisbury. It wasn't a big town, but that's where we lived. My grandmother didn't like that. She liked the country, Second Creek, and I did too. But we had to move. My grandmother got sick. When I was 10 years old, she opened a letter one day and I saw her wiping her eyes. And when Emil got home from work, she said, "Mildred, they gonna take my land. They gonna take my land because somebody ain't been paying the tax." And my Aunt Mildred said, "Mama, who's supposed to pay the tax?" Well, that wasn't important. The taxes just hadn't been paid. And my Aunt Mildred said, "It's $1,500. That's like $1,000,000. I don't have that money." But I remember, with tears standing on her face, my grandmother looked at my Aunt Mildred and she said, "Mildred, that's all I've got. Please save my land." So my Aunt Mildred went to the lady that she worked for and borrowed the money. And the lawyer that filled out the papers for the loan suggested to my Aunt Mildred that we pull down all the buildings standing on the land and the taxes wouldn't be so high. Well, it took my aunt it was a long time. It was spring before we could get out there to pull that house down. But they found a man with a great big old bulldozer and he agreed to tear the house and the two barns and the shed. He agreed to tear them down. And I remember that morning we were at the breakfast table and my Aunt Mildred said to my grandmother, "Mama, we're going out to tear the house down. You want to go with us?" And I remember seeing my grandmother saying, "Oh my God, child, no, I don't want to go." But I said, "I want to go, I want to go." And my Aunt Mildred said, "Naturally, So I got in the car. My Uncle Nesbitt, my Aunt Mildred's brother, he drove us out to Second Creek. And after we had been there about 10 minutes, we heard that old bulldozer coming down the hill. It came around Aunt Sally's house, and it turned, and it parked right up there above the big gully. And I watched it. It was a huge thing, and it looked like it had a tin can on the top, because the top of it kind of blew open, and black smoke came out. And this great big man got out of it, and he walked down the hill, and he said, "Miss Mildred," he shook Amy's hand, and he shook Uncle Nez's hand, he reached for mine, and he shook my whole body. He was a big man. He said, "Let's go in the house and see what's in there." And I hadn't been in that house in a long time. So we ran inside. All the memories. You know, now when I dream about my grandmother's house, when we walked in that day, that's what I remember. There was no furniture in the house, but it was perfectly clean. But in the kitchen, there were still things in the cabinets. And the man who drove the bulldozer said, "Miss Mildred, if you get all this glass and stuff out of here," he said, "it won't be so dangerous for me." He said, "because when I start pushing this building over, this glass will be just like bullets. It'll shoot out, might hurt me, might hurt you all." He said, "just get it out of here." Well, when we moved, my Aunt Mildred said, "Mama, don't bring all them old bowls and all that old depression glass. Just leave it in here. Nobody's gonna use it." And there were those great big old bowls that my grandmother used to prop back up in her arm. She didn't need an electric mixer. She had her right hand. She could beat that batter, and there wouldn't be an air bubble anywhere. But we took those big old bowls. And my Uncle Nesbitt went to the shed and got 3 number 2 tin tubs. And we threw all of those bowls and all of that glass and everything in those tin tubs. And they drug them out of the house, across the yard, and over to the big gully. And they turned them up. And I watched as those bowls rolled down the hill, and as those glasses tumbled and broke. And I remember thinking, something's wrong with this. I just didn't know what it was. But I remember when my uncle pulled one of the tubs back, something had hung on the side, and I grabbed for it. It was an old pressed glass celery dish. It was about that long. And I grabbed for it and I put it under my arm, and my aunt said, "What do you want with that?" I said, "I want to play with it." She said, "Well, you better keep it up out of my way." And the same thing happened with another tub. My grandmother's old tin milk pitcher. I grabbed it too. She said, "You just getting that junk to mess up the room." I said, "I'm going to play with it." We went back in the house, and they started to open drawers and close drawers and open drawers and close drawers. And when Aunt Mia opened one of the drawers, I saw it. I saw it. And I grabbed for it, but she slammed the drawer shut. And I said, "I'll come back to get it," because I wanted it real bad. But she didn't come back in the house. We went out the door and up on the hill. And we stood there. And I watched the man swing himself up into that bulldozer. And he pulled this and he pulled that and he kicked this. And you could hear that thing, no, start up. And the smoke began to fly, and that old tin can started opening and closing. and it was on its way down the hill. And I looked at the bulldozer, and I looked at the house and the bulldozer and the house. And then I remembered, I forgot my treasure. Down the hill I went just as fast as I could go. I ran into the house, grabbed that drawer, pulled it open, grabbed my treasure, and started back out the door. But when I did, I ran straight into my aunt. She was screaming and yelling, "What are you doing? What made you do that? Do you realize you could have been killed? Have you lost your mind? What did you go in there for? Do you know that bulldozer was only about 15 feet from the house? You could have been killed." Well, I was shaking so hard that I couldn't say a word. All I could do was hold up my treasure. And she snatched it from my hand and opened it out. And she said, This is what you risked your life for. Do you realize that you almost got killed going in the house for an old feed sack apron? This is Mama's old feed sack apron." And she threw it at me. And it twisted around my head. And I held it, shaking. She said, "Young lady, let this be a lesson to you. You better keep it. And remember, it almost got you killed." And she drugged me back up on the hill. And I stood there, my hands shaking, holding that apron. And she said, "Don't you ever forget." And I looked at her and I thought, "You think it's an old feed sack apron. To me, this is my magic cloak. When I was a little girl, my grandmother would put it around me to keep me warm when we sat on the porch. It was wool, it was like a blanket. If the mosquitoes were biting, she'd take it off and wrap it around me, and it was like lead, they couldn't bite through. It was magic. When I'd go up the road and fall and skin my knee and come back hollering just as loud as I could, crying, my grandmother would just kneel down on the back porch and take the end of that apron and put it in the water and wipe that blood and grit and dirt off my knee, and it didn't hurt anymore. That apron had medicine in it. And we'd go down and pick up the eggs, and she'd lift it up and tie it up, and she'd put the eggs in it. It was magic. It was a basket. And when folks told me to say certain words that didn't come out so good because I had a speech impediment, and they'd laugh at me, I just stepped behind my grandmother's apron. It made me invisible. Nobody could see me, so nobody could laugh at me anymore. Yeah, it's an old feed sack apron, all right. But it's magic. I'm all grown up now. I know it wasn't magic. But back in the days when I was a little girl and my grandmother was wearing it and using it to take care of me, it was magic then. Sometimes now, when life is so heavy and it's so hard for me to make certain decisions, I open that box and I take out that old feed sack apron. And I put it around my face, and I take a deep breath, and I smell way down inside of it. And I can smell that old rancid butter and that old stale lard and all those wonderful things that my grandmother must have wiped on that apron. And I can also smell the days when it was magic. And some reason, for some strange reason, that decision that I must make just comes easier because of my magic. If you've got a family album, get it out. Look through it. Find those days that were magic for you. And that's the end of that.